Let's continue and let's see what else the geodesic equation can tell us. And actually, it can tell a lot of stuff. Among which, it's going to tell us what are the possible conserved quantities that we can have in GR, such as momentum conservations, angular conservations, and all of that. If there is, or if there is not, because maybe it can also be not conserved. Conserved quantities. So, let's see. So, let's take again our geodesic equation expressed in terms of one forms. I used, no, over d tau is equal to 1/2 d nu alpha beta u alpha u beta. That's exactly the same expression that we had before. No news about that. For a one form. And you understand that we can investigate with this equation the energy momentum conservation, because U is what? Associated to the momentum of particles, of massive particles, in which we have the U alpha is equal to M U alpha. Right? That's the four momentum. And you know that the four momentum is storing information through the gamma factor of the energy of a particle and the three-dimensional momentum of a particle. Okay? So you see that this equation is going to tell you how the four momentum can change with respect to tau, if it is evolving, if it's changing as a function of the four momentum. And the answer is straightforward. The answer is straightforward. There is a G missing here. G alpha beta. Because if we take, for example, the zero component, this can be associated to the energy. If this guy is equal to zero, it means that U zero is a constant, is a conserved quantity. That's as simple as that. And when is this happening? When the derivative of the metric with respect to the quantity, to the direction, to the variable x0, in this case that we are considering, is equal to zero. Okay? So if we go generic again, nu and nu, then this happens when the nu of g alpha beta is equal to zero. Okay? So whenever the metric G is constant along the x nu direction, then the momentum P nu is conserved. Okay? Yes? Yes, here you have a summary.
I mean, couldn't this non-zero derivative be cancelled by the summary?
Well, in principle, yes. I mean, I never tried. In principle, yes. But it's a the attention should be always posed on this one, because whenever this is, the condition, the general condition is this one, right? But this is guaranteed if you have non-vanishing derivatives along a certain direction. I don't know if it is the only, if there is a, I will check. Actually, I never tried to see if there can be cancellations here, because you have U here and U there. I'm not sure. I mean, you can construct some G perhaps where this is happening. Well, actually, by hand you can do it, because you can just impose these terms to be, for example, flipping sign. And you can achieve that mathematically. I don't know if it's physical. Okay.
So this is only two
boxes. I think so. I will check, because I never tried, but I will check. For sure you can construct a G such that this happens. But I don't know if then you would get would be associated with a physical metric. Okay, good. Okay. So this concept is clear, right? That's simple as that. Now, take care, because the index here is low, is a one form. But this guy here is not a one form, is a vector. Therefore, if you want to go from one form to a vector, so if you want to get your u nu, which as you know is associated to p nu, if we are dealing with a massive particle, then this guy is going to be equal to g nu. Let's use mu nu u nu p nu. Right? We need to raise the index. It means that if we want to look at the momentum, this is conserved, but then is g mu nu p nu, which is equal to that, p mu is conserved. Okay? So you go through this equation, which is straightforward. You can identify the one form, which is constant. Then if you want to identify, to understand if the momentum is conserved, or if you want to understand if the energy is conserved, then you need to multiply the metric, because you need to raise the index to see what is the real quantity associated to the four momentum, energy or moment or three-dimensional momentum that is associated to that situation. Okay? Remember that this guy, so if you have the p mu is not equal to p nu. Okay? They are different. There is the metric. So remember that. Let's take an example. To show you that, and we take a metric in which g alpha beta with respect to the angle phi is equal to zero. Why an angle now? Because I'm assuming spherical coordinates. That might be convenient to use if we have, for example, the sun. Because we have a metric that can be expressed as a function of radius and a function of some angle phi. Right? I can reparametrize instead of using Cartesian coordinate. In this scenario, it's more convenient to use the spherical coordinates. And in this case, we have this it is a situation fulfilled. Therefore, we have immediately the understanding that the component phi of our form of the one form associated to the form momentum must be conserved. So we get the metric G phi phi, which is associated to the angles, purely the angles, times P phi. I'm lowering the index, right? This is constant. And now in spherical coordinates, I think that you are going to do it on a sphere in one of the exercises, so you are confident with that. That's equal to Rm, which is coming from the form momentum. And then we have the phi over the tau. Okay? So we have a term coming from the metric. And then we have the form momentum expressed for the phi component. So if you want, I can write as well x phi, okay, which is the angle. And what is that? That's the angular momentum. So you see that this equation is telling you that not the momentum is conserved. It's not P phi conserved. This quantity is conserved, and this quantity is the angular momentum. Okay? Okay, we can have a break because I need more space. And just a little summary. So that we go through the concept. We started by looking again, investigating again the geodesic equation and see if we can change our parameterization through our physics, through our Lagrangian approach. We understood that we can parameterize the trajectories through the proper time tau, and we ask ourselves, can we use some other parameterization? Let's see. So we introduced a generic parameterization. We plugged in, we just did a few simple derivatives, and in the end we arrived at the very same geodesic equation with an additional term which is related to second derivatives of the reparameterization that we are using. Okay? So if we want to recover the very same geodesic equation that we started with, we want the second derivatives of this function describing the reparameterization equal to zero, which means that this equation must be of this form. Okay, just a rescaling of tau plus a constant. They are called, all the lambdas, all the functions that are called like this, they are called affine parameters. Okay, as I said, you can clearly still use any parameterization you would like, but you just make your life more complicated because you need then to carry around this additional term. Then we turn back to gravity after we have seen how to deal and how we can play with the geodesic equation. We turn back to gravity and we look at the weak field limit in which we got our assumptions, which is weak gravitational field, as the name of the approximation of the limit says, non-relativistic motions, and static, a static case in which the metric is not evolving as a function of time. We used our geodesic equation, in this case for one forms, and we looked for the gamma zero component. So these are four equations. We looked for the one relative to tau, and we found this relationship between, these are two missing, this relationship between the proper time and the time t. Then we look for the space components, 1, 2, and 3. And we imposed in the end that the acceleration that is associated to our particle must be equal to what we expect, what we would expect from Newtonian mechanics, therefore the gradient to a gradient of a potential. Okay? by linking these two equations, we can identify the perturbation in our metric that gives us the full metric. So that's what we obtain at first order. Going to higher order, and if one would stop at the first order, would believe that the space component, EE, are equal to 1. Okay? That's not the case, because going at higher orders, one realizes that actually we have a correction which has the same magnitude of the space components. And then the mixed terms for the space components are all equal to 0. Okay? Good. Then we say, what else can we use our geodesic equation for? Only for the trajectories? Not. We can also use it to investigate conserved quantities within gravity. And it's quite trivial, because you can start again with your geodesic equation expressed for one forms. That's u nu. You know that u nu is associated to four momentum of massive particles. And by looking at the conditions for which this expression is fulfilled, namely the four velocity and the four momentum is not evolving as a function of the proper time, then this guy must be conserved. And this guy is conserved whenever we have this condition fulfilled. Meaning the metric along the nu direction, the x nu direction, is equal to 0. Then this guarantees you, so the properties of the metric tells you what are the quantities that are conserved. Okay? And I gave you an example for the angular for a spherical case. We looked for the angular the direction, so along a circle with a fixed radius around our source of the gravitational field, of source of space-time distortion. And we find out that actually the quantity that is conserved is not the momentum, but is the angular momentum. Okay? Because what was conserved was this p with the phi below, so it was a one form that we need to associate to a vector to have an understanding of the four momentum, and this guy is the guy conserved, the angular momentum. Okay? Later we will continue with arguments and discussion about the conserved quantities, in which we will try to generalize our approach and not only looking for the components of the four momentum that are conserved, but we are going to look for combinations, for projection of the four momentum on different directions. And these vectors on which we make the projections and we have the conservation law fulfilled are called killing vectors. Don't be scared. Okay? They're not dangerous. Killing was a person. Okay? So there is nothing cruel or, something morbid in all of that. So it was just a brilliant scientist who find out this property. And look that the conservation law is in GR. It's crazy simple, isn't it? Also, this approach is super simple. But it took Einstein and Hilbert a lot of time to figure it out, to understand how to deal with conserved quantities in GR. And to find out the answer, they had to call Noether, Emmy Noether, because they couldn't really figure it out. So they had different approaches both of them have two different approaches to try to have an interpretation, a physical interpretation of the equations. Klein was also involved. And they say, I don't know. Hilbert said, let's ask Emmy Noether. And then she started to play with this kind of stuff. And she was not only interested in energy conservations. They were merely focused on energy conservations. And she came out with also her famous theorem, the Noether theorem. And she was a mathematician. She was not only asking herself, what is energy conservation? She asked herself, what are conservations in general? Okay? And came up with the brilliant results that we use daily. Physicists use it kind of every day. Okay, yes?
I think the question is why we can address it is because we do it for all of you. Right? The question was if we can construct something with the derivative of g, to be zero even though the derivative doesn't have to be
Yes.
I think the argument goes because for all new, for every new we put, we have this. So even if the construct is one type, it doesn't mean that the other components would eventually follow the same.
You don't quite get it. I mean, G alpha beta, we can construct it as we want,
yeah,
in theory. Ah, yes. Ah, that because they're linked together. Ah, yeah, yeah, you're right. Yeah, maybe there is a link that forbids that. I will check on that because, that's an interesting question. Okay, thanks. Good, so let's have a break so we can meet again at 10:25, and we will resume with the killing vectors. So, we end up by understanding if I have this condition that is associated to the fact that G mu with respect to the direction alpha beta with respect to the x nu component is equal to zero, so if this is the case, then we know that P nu is a constant, is conserved. Now, from this, we understand that we can identify conserved quantities. And we can ask ourselves, is this the only way we can do it? No, we can generalize a little bit the expression. We can see if there are linear combinations of the components of the momentum, meaning we are projecting the four momentum on some direction in which this is fulfilled. Still, we have a conserved quantity. So the question is, do we have a P nu that projected on some vector alpha give us a conserved quantity? Okay, so look that I'm using a covariant derivative with respect to some direction beta. But this is a scalar product. And scalars, the covariant derivative for scalar, is the standard derivative of the same scalar. Therefore, just a comma, not a semicolon. Beta. So if this is fulfilled, meaning I'm projecting P alpha on some vector that's equal to zero, then it means that P alpha along that direction is a constant, is conserved. And this vector, if they exist, this was the component, so this is a vector. They are called killing vectors. Yes? Ah, okay, I thought there was a question. Okay, they are called killing vectors. Again, quite a simple concept, right? We have P, we just find, look if there is a vector, a direction, over which we can make a projection of our vector by applying the scalar product and see if this guy is conserved. And The vector defining the projections are called killing vectors. Again, after a person, so killing was a person. Let's see a very simple case. In which we have that G, we used alpha, beta, with respect to x gamma direction, equal to zero. It means, as we have seen before, that P gamma is a conserved, which of course means P gamma over the direction, P gamma is equal to zero. Okay? Good, let's see what is the killing vector then. Then we have that P alpha, I just used the expression that I wrote up there, comma gamma, because that's the guy which is the X gamma that is conserved. This must be equal, Gesundheit, P gamma, comma gamma, equal to zero. Right? Which is this condition. Then, what is the killing vector? Well, it's very simple. We need to find the vector such that P alpha, killing vector alpha, is equal to that. So we need to kind of transform this alpha into a gamma. Therefore, see, alpha is equal to the Kronecker delta, delta gamma alpha. That's our killing vector. And what is it? That's a vector, so this, you see the components of this vector are equal to zero or to one. They are all equal to zero except for the component alpha equal to gamma. It identifies a direction. Okay, that's trivial. Okay? Then you can build up more complicated cases and you will have exercises to play with that. But the idea is this one, and that's how you can search for the killing vectors, okay? You impose a condition and you see if you can fulfill it. Maybe it's not possible. And the killing vector for doesn't exist. Then one can move on and say, ah, cool, nice. There are these vectors that I can identify. Let's see if I can create a field out of them. Because the metric is depends on position. Because we have the metric G alpha beta depend on some position. X mu, I move around, it can be different. Therefore, if something is conserved in one position, perhaps it's not conserved there. Or perhaps if I want for a quantity to be always conserved, I need to kind to move around, okay? To identify the position X such that the condition is always fulfilled. Therefore, it's convenient to introduce killer vector field. Killing vector fields. And the idea is simple. So just before we have a vector, see, and this is going to be a field. So given a position, I can define a vector, as I can define a scalar field, like the temperature in this room. I have a temperature in this position, its temperature as a function of the position. I have the wind in this room, air is moving, for the very same position, I can identify a vector defining the velocity of the wind. Different position, different position, different position, for every position I can identify the vector identifying the velocity of the wind. This is a vector field. Okay, it's simple as that. Good. To find out some constraint to identify this sort of fields, we make a very simple, we play a trick. So we just have the same condition that we have before, P alpha killing vector, I use it above, doesn't matter. Well, let me keep it as in the lecture notes, so that you can also notice something. Because this is a scalar product, and I can flip it. I can flip the indices. I get the same result, right? Therefore, I can write it in this form or in that form. And then, yeah, here I use the beta. Keep in mind that this was done for convenience. I can do it, but that always in the back of our mind. And we need to account for this whenever we multiply this object for another vector. This is a product, therefore I apply just the chain rule to this object, so the product rule of this object. Therefore we have P beta, P alpha, then we have xi alpha, and then we have the derivative with respect to beta, plus P beta, xi alpha, and then P alpha, comma beta. But now look at that. I'm not doing anything. I'm just moving here such that you can see better something, which is this little bit here. What is that? That's just the basic equation. Look, P beta, beta, beta. P beta, P alpha, but the derivative is respect to beta. So here we have this summatory. This is a directional derivative, but P is the momentum. That's the geodesic equation multiplied M. Therefore, is identical to zero. It's a geodesic. It identifies a geodesic. Therefore, we are left only with this term. Okay? And we are looking for this guy to be conserved. Therefore, this must be equal to zero. What is the condition for this B for this guy here to be always zero? You see, now we can have a condition that we identify here. We have the first guy which is symmetric. P beta P alpha, I can change them. I always get P beta P alpha. P beta P alpha is equal to P alpha B beta. This is symmetric. So what has to be this guy such that the product of a symmetric tensor is equal to zero? This must be antisymmetric. Okay? The product of a symmetric tensor times an antisymmetric tensor is identically zero always. Okay? So again, just product rule for derivative. Keep in mind that we started with a covariant derivative. Okay? This is done. You can do it if you are using this approach. This is completely legitimate. But if you apply the chain rule to this object, you need to carry the covariant derivative. Because then you're going to have the covariant derivative of a vector. It's not anymore a scalar. Okay, so keep this in mind. Here we identify the geodesic equation that drops, and we are left with that symmetric and antisymmetric tensor. This is giving us a constraint to identify. Hey, where are you hiding? To identify the Killing vector field. Antisymmetric. What does it mean? That xi alpha comma zero beta is equal to the same, but we indices flip. And we have a minus in front here. That's antisymmetric. Therefore, my condition to identify the Killing vector is this one. This condition identifies the Killing vectors. Yes? Ah, yes, you're right, sorry. Thanks, plus. There is a minus, you bring it on the other side and get a plus. So this is the condition. To identify the killing vector fields. Okay, so you see that everything is linked. There is a covariant derivative here. Which is linked to what? To the affine connection. You see, the affine connection, its nature, the nature of the affine connection, defines the killing vector field. Okay? If we are using the assumptions for torsion free and the metric compatibility, then this is related to the metric G. And now you see the link between G and what we were talking about before. But again, keep it in mind that here the real actor is the covariant derivative, and therefore is the affine connection. So we can stop here, and also for non-GR theories, that includes, for example, torsion different than zero, then the affine connection defines the killing vector fields, and therefore defines what are the quantities that are going to be conserved. Again, isn't this simple? You see, GR is simple in the end. And it took geniuses to understand and interpret correctly all of that. Just an historical parenthesis about Newton. When she was called by Hilbert to work with him and try to figure out what to do, he couldn't hire her as a scientist, because she was a woman, and he had to hire her as an assistant, just kind of secretary. This was the only way he found to pay her a salary, because she worked like for ages without being paid in Germany, because it was not allowed for having a position at university, not even studying. So she was one of the first ones studying at university. And when he got her position in Germany, at the time, again, women were not allowed to be professors, but she had all the credits to do it. And the director there wanted her, okay? And tried to motivate the reason why he wanted to have her. It's not because, women are also good in physics. No, his motivation was, it's known that the brain of women, of females, is not suited for mathematical thinking. But she's a rare exception. Okay, so think at the time, what are we talking about? And imagine how many geniuses, female geniuses, we have lost because of that. Okay, good. So give a look at Newton life, it's interesting. Okay, so let's now continue and start to approach and get deeper and deeper and approaching and going closer and closer to gravity for Rea. Because what we did now, again, is just differential geometry. They are just studying properties that are associated to the killing vectors that you see is just something related to the affine connection. And affine connection is just a covariant derivative. There's no physics there whatsoever. Okay, these are mathematical properties of the object that we are dealing with, so they're crucial, but that's no physics, that's mathematics. And when we derived the weak field limit, we imposed all the differential geometry businesses that we are creating to be equal to Newtonian mechanics. When we derived the Euler-Lagrange equation through the variational approach to derive the equation of motion of particles in a field, we assumed that the metric was already there. Right? It didn't pop up. It's not that we said, here is a stone, here is a planet, here is a star, here is a black hole, and this is the metric. We didn't say that. We say it exists a metric, and it's there. Then all the rest follows. Then the equation of motion must be like that. Okay? So we need to do a step forward and try to define objects, identify objects that are directly related to physical properties, if you wish, and they can give you explicitly the fact that the space-time that you are living in is curved. Because if we take the affine connection and we set it equal to zero, we say, okay, it's equal to zero, but this doesn't guarantee you that we are dealing with a curved space-time, because you can always choose a frame, like our free-falling bottles, in which the affine connection inside the bottle is equal to zero. Okay? So the affine connection alone doesn't allow you to see if the space-time is curved or not. Therefore, we are going to define new quantities that are intrinsic properties of the space-time. In general, curved manifolds. That we want to be of a tensorial form. Because if we have a tensor at hand, and we can set our tensor, let's call it tensor A, alpha, beta, whatever, which is equal to zero in one frame. Okay, then this is equal to zero in all frames. That's the power of tensors. And the way around, if it's not equal to zero, then is never going to be equal to zero. So we identify something that no matter what, if there is curvature, then cannot be set to zero. With a fine connection, yes, we can. Not the case. In fact, it's not a tensor. And we need to find combinations or something a little bit more sophisticated, such that this is revealed. And actually, we are going to see that to have something that is a tensorial form and not and reveals cannot be set to zero if there is curvature, or is going to be related to derivatives of the affine connection. So if you move from one position to another, your affine connection can be changing. There is, you need a derivative. There was a question, yes? Well, it depends on the symmetries of your system. For example, without introducing the Killing vectors, by using an appropriate coordinate system, like a spherical system for a central spherical object, right? The metric is always the same quantity if we move along with a fixed radius around the central object. Then the Killing vector is just the basis defining the coordinate along angles. Okay, so it's related to symmetries in the system. So if in this sense is related to physical quantities. If you are using a manifold for, I don't know, studying the manifold, then you have the Killing vectors and they don't have a physical meaning. But whenever you associate to a metric to a gravitational field, then it acquires a physical meaning. And still, in general, is something that is related to the symmetries of your system. Okay, good. So let's investigate that. And the guys we are going to investigate are going to be the curvature. Which is also called Riemann tensor. And torsion. That we already encountered. So we already know something about torsion. So you know that torsion T is equal is we define it like that, right? So it's the difference between the affine connection between two terms with the indexes flipped, the lower indexes flipped. This was a torsion. And then you can say, hey, my guy, hey, you're looking for a tensorial object. But here we are making the difference between objects that are not tensors. Yes, but the part of the transformation that, and you remember that we showed the transformation which was of non-tensorial origin. It was like a tensorial part and a non-tensorial one. But then when you make the difference one, the difference between the two, the non-tensorial part of the transformation vanishes. And in the end, you get a tensor. So this guy is a tensor. Yes, it is a tensor. Okay? Good. I don't know if I have time. So I can start the image. No, let's stop here. I mean, we had a very short break in the middle, so don't want to steal you too much time. Maybe it would be too short, so we can stop here. We will continue. So we have seen a lot of stuff today as well. I mean, it was going quite slow, but the concepts are extremely important. So we investigated once more the geodesic equation. We have seen how much information this equation can give us, not only the equation of motion for a free particle, not only can be associated to the motion of a free particle, but can also give us precious information about conserved quantities in our system. We have also seen how we can generalize our concept, not restrict ourselves to the form momentum only, but we can generalize the concept by studying the projection of the four momentum over some other vector. And then we saw how to identify the vectors, well, individual vectors, as we did there, and we identified also the condition for which we can constrain the field, the Killing vector field, that is giving us all the information necessary to quantify the conserved quantities, if there are, in our system. Okay? One last comment about the geodesic equation. There, and also a misconcept that is kind of going around with respect to the cosmological redshift, no? You always have in mind we are sitting here, the galaxies are moving away from us, and because of the Doppler shift, they look redder than what they should be if they would be at rest with respect to us. That's the wrong interpretation. What we have is that the metric of the universe is changing as a function of time. And the energy of the photons is not conserved. You have a photon, the universe is expanding, the metric therefore is changing, and the energy of the photons is changing accordingly. Okay? That's why you should speak about cosmological redshift. That's something different. That's related not to the Doppler shift, like they're going away, but it's related to the fact that the metric is changing as a function of time. Also because defining differences in vectors doesn't make sense anymore on a curved space-time. because I have a vector identifying I have a velocity here, so which is identified by a vector, and I have another location there away from me. I have to parallelly transport, and I don't have anymore a direction which is coherent with the other velocity. I cannot play the role of just making a difference of velocities to see, I cannot make just one vector minus the other vectors, because they're belonging to different vector, tangent vector space, right? Therefore, differences of vectors in curved spacetime don't make any sense. That's why you should speak, for example, if we speak about ourselves and the velocity of galaxies with respect to us, you need to speak in terms of variation of the metric, okay? So that's a cosmological ratio. Okay, good. We can resume next time. We will continue with torsion before we abandon this tensor for the last time, for good. And the curvature tensor that will open the path to create the Einstein's fields equation that are described in GR. Okay? Thank you very much, and see you next time.